welcome to another in my series of conversations. My name is John Cornicello. I'm going live on Mondays and Thursdays at 10 Pacific and 1 Eastern. Coming up next week, we have Jack Resnicki talking about copyright for photographers on Monday, August 10th. And Michelle Bates will be in to talk about plastic cameras and performance photography on Thursday, the 13th. Karina Alevecchios is coming back for part two of Fine Art Portrait Photography. I believe that's on the 20th. But you can see the full schedule and recordings at cornicello.com conversations. Today, my guest is photographer and musician Holger Mischke, joining us from Germany. I met Holger through these conversations and fell in love with some of his black and white work. So let me introduce Holger and take a look at his work. Go ahead, Holger, let's hear it from you.
Yeah, hi, everybody. And it's good to see you all. It's because I was thinking the other day when John invited me to this, and then he wrote something like on a comment on Facebook, something like, I'm looking forward to learning a lot from you that day. And I'm like, I'm not doing that long. And a lot of you people have probably a lot more experience in this than I have, but I think there's still, it's a conversation. It's not like a classroom thing that I'm sitting here and telling you something you wouldn't know already. Also, I don't have this kind of story that I can say, well, somebody gave me my first camera at my sixth birthday or something, and my uncle showed me a dark room and I was hooked. It was never like that. I had a friend 25 years ago who did film photography, and I saw that, and we shared an apartment. He had a dark room, a makeshift dark room in the bathroom, but it was never for me. It had to go digital before I got hooked on that. So that happened, and at the risk of someone leaving, I only been doing this for like 6 years. Because at the time I was a bike and hike guide, I was a travel guide, and I was a bike mechanic in places like Thailand and Spain, and Africa, wherever.
Is that motorbikes or bicycles?
What?
Motorbikes or bicycles?
No, bicycles. Okay. I was taking people on these bicycle tours, and I fixed the bikes and everything because I couldn't afford to go any place abroad. I just didn't have the money. And the first time I was in Ireland, I photographed the whole thing on a Motorola smartphone. And after that, I was like, there has to be something better than that. Because Ireland is so great. It's like a postcard image at every corner. It's unbelievably beautiful. And I knew I had to go back, and so I came back with a DSLR I bought the next year. And from then on, it's been, it didn't take me long to find out what I wanted, I guess. Black and white was, I think I have only 5 color images in my portfolio. The rest is all black and white, because just the aesthetics, that's what I like. And I found some people like Harold Davis, who was my mentor for a couple of months, and work with those people for a while. And now I think the thing I'm doing, like John said, I'm musician. I doesn't pay any bills or something, but I play jazz music on the guitar, and I write. And then I started combining these things. And the first thing that I do now is whenever I take a picture, there will be text coming with it. Just a couple of lines, not to explain anything, but to give an idea of that's what I felt, that's what came into my mind when I shot it or when I developed it. And it's more like, see, this is what I'm thinking, this is what I'm feeling, and now it's on you. Now give me your story, give me what you think when you look at this. So that's what I combine. And the latest idea is I put together a 5-piece jazz quintet with old friends who know me and who know what I think and what I feel. And now we improvise to looking at these images, and the text is recorded. It's a short story then, it's a bit longer than what I usually do. And we improvise over what we hear and what we see. So the first thing, combining the text with the images, is called Two Sides Now, which goes back to a song by Joni Mitchell, is called Both Sides Now. Mm-hmm. And then we take it one step further, combining the music with the images and the text, and that's Three Sides Now, but that's coming up. whenever we get ready with it. So that's pretty much what I'm doing.
Cool. You want to show us some of the work?
Oh, yeah, already. Okay, I can share this. Wait a second, I gotta get out of this. And share the screen. Everybody look at the desktop, yes. And there it is. So this is a line from both sides now, or like four lines actually, that give you a feel of what I'm totally confused by life, and I'm fascinated too, but that's what got me hooked on this song and what gave me ideas for the images. So it's not presented usually like this. I have a print of the frame, and I will give you the text in a little booklet or something. But this is just for the purposes of this meeting, that you can see what the image is and what the text is. This is actually shot on a Coolpix P7000. So I don't care really what it is. It's an iPhone or a DSLR or whatever. And this has been close to my home, only like 10K or something. And it's just the sky that's totally fascinating to me, because it looks like water. It could be clouds, it could be whatever. It's just nature. And the rest is what we do. It's like more linear and harder and colder than what nature does. And this is in a forest nearby. I don't remember the camera. That's actually not that important, I guess. Like I said, sometimes the text makes sense when you look at the image. Sometimes it feels like it's got nothing to do with anything in the image. It's just what comes up in my mind, which might be weird at times, I guess. I thought this was interesting. This is Normandy, because when you cover the lower half of the image, the pole on the right, that could be actually a tower at the same size of the lighthouse. And then you reveal the lower half and you realize, no, it's jumping to the forefront. It's a pole. It's a lot smaller than that. And the little things like the boat in the back and that. And this is in the Netherlands, the North Sea. It's not too many images like that I do, but I like this because it's a hint of what the water is, and you still realize what it is. And of course the two birds which are not copied. I mean, you look at it closely, you see it's not the same posture. Just happened to be like that.
And folks watching along, if you have any questions for Holger or myself as we go along, feel free to unmute and join in.
Wait a second. Oops,
they're beautiful photos.
Oh, thank you. That's in France. There's a village we happen to find. It's at the end of a valley. And if you don't want to go there, you will never find it. And it's only like 24 people or something. And at night, all you hear is a creek and birds. And this is a path they call Philosopher's Path, because they had like wooden signs with Walt Whitman text or text by any other philosopher you could read while you were walking there. And I just totally like this one. The light is actually, I didn't do too much. I photoshopped a little bit, but the light is actually the way it was on that day.
Could you please go back to the previous image?
This one?
No, the neck. Can you enlarge it like you did a little while ago?
On this one here?
Yes.
On the water?
Yes. Keep going. Can you?
Oh, to make it larger, or what do you need?
To make it larger.
Oh, okay.
Okay. You see the wave over on the right?
Yeah, the big one on the lower right?
Yes.
Yeah.
You see those lines?
Yeah.
Are you doing something very interesting and beautiful to the image to get it that way? It looks like a painter's brush.
It could be with something like, let me go back to the side. Yeah. With this also, you'll see when you get closer here, see this? That's topaz simplifying. That's something, if I have something like this, which is very, very busy, has a lot of little details, and in forest you get that a lot, then I'm thinking sometimes it's way too much. And there are settings in topaz simplify that will actually simplify the whole thing. But you see, it's not getting, it's still a lot of detail in here, but it was a lot worse before. So I think
the water is beautiful.
It looks like, it has a painterly effect on that. It looks like brush strokes. That's true. But I'm not sure on this. I don't have records on every single image what I did. Sometimes I wouldn't be able to replicate it because if they're older, especially, and I was trying out things and I wasn't thinking of writing it down. I have an image that comes later of a forest in Belgium. I have no idea how I did that.
Do you do a lot of work in topaz?
No, just for, I have topaz simplify and what is the other thing? Adjust, I think is the name. And I only use simplify for these kind of things when I have too much detail in there or I want something painterly. And then it's a layer in Photoshop. It's so I don't have 100% opacity on there, just as so much so I can see what I want to see.
Thank you.
No problem. Oops, now I have to say that. That's again in France. That's 14th century church, a small church in that 24 people village. And that was, it felt like that day. It was very cold in that church, although outside it was really sunny and warm and everything. But nobody was in there. And I had this thing for like a half day for myself. And I was looking at that and it's like this texture and the light in there was incredible. And this, I thought, of course, the lines, it's obvious why I'm doing this. I like things that point to some point beyond the horizon that you can't see. And to me, that felt like, I don't know, Idaho or Iowa. Iowa, I think Iowa is more like it. But it's actually, it's here where I live. And this again, it's, but I don't think this time topaz wasn't involved. This is, it looks more like an etching. But since it was, I think it was January or February, and there's snow on the ground, so this whole thing was monochrome in nature already. There was not really too much color you had to pull from that, and not really do too much. It's just to get detail, all these little things that makes it look like an etching, really. It has something very British to me for some reason, not all. Oh, and this is... this is in Spain, and I walked up to this, and my wife was with me, and she already knows when we walk somewhere, she knows. Oh, he's gonna stop at this. He's gonna want to take a picture of this, and so this is an iPhone shot, and I took the shot just I don't know to share it later on, while I'm still out there, and then I took the DSLR and took some shots, and when I came home, I realized that was the best frame, the best composition. For some stupid reason, I never managed to do the same composition of this shot on the DSLR. I had, I don't know, 20 shots or something of this, and nothing looked as good as this, so I just stuck with the iPhone thing.
Holger, your writings are absolutely beautiful too, and I love the way the text, of course, goes with the image. Do you jot something down as you're standing there usually, or do you wait until you're home and editing your images?
Oh, it's not, there's no rule to it. It's really, it could be that I'm in this case, I think it was later. It can be either that I'm standing there because I always have, like Ansel Adams says, you should always have a notepad with you when you're going out photographing. So I always have that. And it could be that I write something down there or when I'm editing or at the end, just before I'm printing or something. It is somewhere between capture and print, whenever it comes. It's like, right.
No rules then, right?
No. It's really, only about the feeling. If you probably know that feeling when you're out photographing and you find something and you know, oh, this is gonna be a keeper. and this vision comes up of how this is going to look like once you're done with it, and you just keep photo. It's not just that you take one image, you keep working that one spot and that one view that you had right there, because you know this is exciting and I know this is going to look good and that. And it's the same feeling with the text when I know that, because I might have thoughts already when I'm shooting, but once I have the right thought that I think this one goes perfectly with this image, for whatever reason, I don't even know what the reason is.
The previous image as well with the stone pillars, that was...
this one.
I guess actually, that one. I love the text you put on that one as well. Anyway, very nice.
Are those all original writings?
Yeah. It started out with, we all do this. We all name our images, I hope. And even if it's only tree at sundown or something. But I started like that too. And then I started thinking, nah, I want something better. I want something like you would call a movie or something. So I started that. And then it was like, nah, I still want something better. And then it came to these. Of course, they still have names. Because this one, for instance, is, let me see, All I Need is what this is called.
It's interesting. I like the storylines much better than a title. I don't title my photos. I figured, because sometimes giving a title tells people a direction to go that they may not have wanted to. Without a title, then they can go where they want to. But these stories with it work much better.
It's I still would see, that's what I said, that I wouldn't present it like this. I wouldn't have the text on the actual print. And the same with once we have this project together with the music also, I would the idea is that you get these three parts and you can enjoy them separately, and then you can put them together at whatever you can just look at the image and listen to the music, or you could look at the image and read the text, or read the text and listen to the music.
Yeah, that's a conversation my wife and I have when we go to museums, is people that go look at the image first in the museum, or go to the placard first to read about it. You know, sometimes I wish there were no placards there and you just got to take in.
Covered, so you know, just first take the image in, then have your own idea. Maybe because it's interesting, it might be that your idea or your feelings or whatever you think about that image might change the moment you see the text. Mm-hmm. So the order in which you do that, you can, I mean, it's once you've seen it, and once you've read the text, it's pretty much you're done. You can't forget that totally. Yeah.
I'd like to ask a very sophomoric question, which is, I'm going to assume that you sell prints.
Yeah, they're for sale. Yeah, let's put it like that.
Okay. How does somebody identify the image to you that they've seen if there's no title?
Well, no, there is a title. It's just that now here in Lightroom, I didn't put it on the image itself.
Oh, okay.
I'd have to do that, and then you see it up there.
Yes. Okay.
And yeah, this one I thought was interesting because there's so many textures in this.
Yes, I was just going to say the combination of textures on this is fantastic.
It's the sand on the bottom, the wood of this beach hut thing or whatever it is, the dune, which is, and even in the dune there are several different textures. Yeah. This one here, this stuff which looks like lava running down or something.
Yeah.
And the grass up there and the sky, it was just a total overload of information on this one.
And just the number of natural textures, and we've got this beach house. Yes. Similar but different. I love that image. I love many of these images, but that one in particular for me is just fantastic.
It's always, I like it when I mean both like this one, there's nothing man-made in this one, which is called And Miles to Go. And you probably, if you've read who wrote this, And Miles to Go Before I Sleep,
Robert Frost.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. That was totally what I felt there. So there's nothing man-made in this, but in this it is, and it was like the first one with the wires and the post and in front of the sky. Sometimes the combination is good to see whether is what we do in nature, if you put something in nature, does it fit or does it disturb? Is that anything good? Or it's, a lot of times we just put something in there in nature. When with this, I can live with this beach hut. It's not that bad, really. But if you did put something concrete in here, like a stupid hotel or something, that would be, and I wouldn't even like to photograph that because it's really too much. I can live with something like this, but I think it's not too bad to still have beauty in images. Because sometimes people want to photographers want to, what is it called? Provoke a reaction from me by putting something or including something ugly in there. I don't see the need for that. I want people to have my images in their homes, and it's not very likely that you hang something in your home that's just ugly.
Well, if you go back to that previous image, one of the things I like about it is that there's this subtle anthropological message about our involvement with nature. Here you have this rich, multi-textured natural world, and we have beach structure number 180. So you know there's at least 179 others of these things in nature, in this spot. And this one sort of blends because of how you've done a wonderful job with the processing. But it's like, here's this beautiful nature. And by the way, there's all these things littered down the beach, but they can be pretty too.
They can be. I have another image of these, of a line of maybe 20 of these huts built in. They're like curved. They're not just in a line. The line is curved and you're looking down the beach. And it actually looks pretty nice. And they did I can't remember the, actually looking at it because it's here on the wall and it's in black and white. And I think, what was the original color of that? I can't remember. But it's it looked good on that.
So
but it's,
where was this made?
What?
Where was this?
This is in the Netherlands, Zeeland. It's an island up on the North Sea.
Do you also have this in color?
Not right here. I would have to look for it.
This was done digitally?
Yeah.
Okay, so in effect, it is a color image that you've printed in black and white.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. It's beautiful.
Thank you. So this is in Belgium. Like I said, that's the, maybe I can get these out of the way. Oops.
Just love the depth of this one.
Yep.
That's the rhythm of it is, mm-hmm. I totally love that. And the, well, it's always different once you've been there. We came there and this, you see this snow is pristine. Nobody walked on that. And it was early in the day and there's a sound, there's a quiet in these woods in the morning when nobody's there and you just hear a little bit of the wind there. And sometimes the sounds when some of the snow just slides off the branches up there. It was just amazing. It felt colder than it looked like. But a coldness that comes not from temperature, but from the surroundings, just from what you see and what you feel.
Yeah, but it gets cold under the trees when there's snow. I love snowshoeing. And I love that moment where there's no one else around and it's just there's this quiet in the snow that is just wonderful.
It damps everything.
Yeah.
This is one of the first images I saw of yours. And I just loved it.
This is also like how the way that I got there, this is Greece. This is the island of Naxos in the Aegean Sea. And the way I had to photograph when I was out there, I had a bike tour in Africa and I just had a point and shoot. And I didn't have much time. I had to shoot like from the bike or something. Mm-hmm. And this was, I remember we went with the group that I had, we went down to a taverna, a restaurant for dinner. And I came past this building and I could just take one shot because the group wasn't waiting. They were hungry. They wanted to go to the restaurant. So I get this one shot of this. And for some reason, I don't even know how that worked. I get this, it looks like this this miniature effect. What's it called? Shift?
Tilt.
Yeah. And I have no idea how I did that. It was just past this thing, took that one snapshot and boom, it looked like that. Of course, then the question was like a bit of sharpening here and there and the black and white conversion, of course. But still that the way that I had to take the shots because I was working when I was taking them, they had a lot to do with, if you think about that sometimes when you look at the images, thinking, I only had that one shot. I couldn't work the scene really. I just walked by and Bing did it. That, to me, it feels totally different than if I thought, well, if I had the time to actually stand there for like half hour or something, maybe it would have looked different, but this is all I got. This changes the whole feel for the image, for me at least.
Can you talk a little bit about your black and white conversion? Are you selecting a lot of details and working on particular details?
It's interesting to see for me when I look back, when I have like a 500px account and I look through what I published and you look over the years and you remember, I did this with that camera. And so in the beginning, I was only doing Lightroom because I bought, that was before the subscription thing. So I bought Lightroom, I only had Lightroom, and then I got the Nick collection, Silver FX Pro, and that Silver FX Pro is pretty much always involved in what I do because it works great for me, and with the control point thingy, that you got so much control over everything. But you could still go, of course, a lot further, which I've done in Photoshop or something. And there's a lot of ways. If you look at I read From Oz to Kansas by Vincent Versace, which has a lot of processes to get to black and white conversion, and Harold Davis did a couple of books about black and white, and I have this monochromatic HDR photography book by him that's pretty good that helped me. But it's, of course, it's not, when you look at the image, it's not always, there's not just one method. You could just work with all of these images. Like I said, the one with the woods here, like I can't remember. I absolutely cannot remember because it was so long ago, and at that time I didn't make any notes about how I did this. But again, here was Topaz was somehow involved. It was something like there was a filter in there that made the tree trunks look the way they did, but I couldn't remember all of it. But really looking at the image, and then I go through Lightroom, of course, for the raw conversion and the basic stuff. And then I would usually go to Photoshop and do some little things there. But most of the time, I'm really thinking, I'm trying to get back to that to make it simpler. I mean, I can see that even with just Lightroom and Nick effects, I could get something very decent out of that. And of course, I could go to Photoshop and get something super decent out of that if I invest like another 1,000 hours of learning how Photoshop freaking works. Because I'm a geekish person. I would love to do that, but I just don't have the time because I think I'd rather be out there making new images instead of investing an incredible amount of time in learning how to edit images I can't make because I'm trying to learn that.
Yeah, there are so many softwares out there, and that's kind of how I feel about Nick. I Lightroom and Photoshop, I go back and forth all the time, but it is like learning one more software is, I know it's a fact, and Topaz too. I've never used Topaz.
It's not, when I see something, I would have to be convinced, like when Lee Veris was here, last week or something, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I saw some of his stuff in his 10 channel workflow. It's very, very interesting. It's like the luminosity mask thing is totally interesting to me. And I will eventually at some point learn about that. I know. Because that is something I see it and I know, yet I feel that is something that would be useful for me. But I think you have to filter that out because, I mean, of course, to learn Photoshop 100% is a no-go. You can't do that. I mean, people like Glenn Dewis or Lee Veris or somebody, they know so much. They probably forgotten more than I will ever know about Photoshop.
Don't forget that Jeff Shuey guy too.
Oh, yeah. I remember him. Yeah.
You look so clean cut today.
Yeah, I thought about a haircut, right? But it's, yeah, it's, when I find something that I think I can really benefit from, I will learn that. But otherwise, I think you should know as much as you need to make a good image. But just to learn something because it's there and you might eventually need it at some point, that's just a waste of time, I guess.
You know, he brings up an interesting issue that has to do with something that I remember from my previous life, starting out in photography. And it had to do with, you want to be a photographer, an image maker, or do you want to be a darkroom technician? And we sort of have, close the gap between the two because of Photoshop. I don't mean that in a derogatory way, but in terms of when I was doing a lot of advertising, all of a sudden in the digital aspect of it, they said, well, you do Photoshop, don't you? And I said, sure. And I did do Photoshop retouching, but they wouldn't pay me for doing the retouching on the image that I had created. But yet, if in the old days, they would take the image I created, give it to the lab to print as a dye transfer, and then the retoucher would work on this enlarged dye transfer and everybody would get paid. Over the years, we've shrunk down to, we now have to be not only the image maker, but the darkroom technician. And it becomes problematic, like he said, that you want to keep it simple. Because we're more interested in the final product, what it actually looks like, as opposed to how we got there.
Yeah.
That's what I have to say.
Yeah.
But it's also that I think you have to think about who are you producing it for? I mean, for one thing, of course, it's that I want to be happy with what I see.
Exactly.
The main reason, always. But then, if I want to sell this, I'm probably not going to sell this to anybody of you, because you have your own images. Photographers don't tend to buy so much from other photographers. But I know this from exhibitions and other photographers come and they ask me, well, how did you do that? And we're talking about technical aspects, but the people who are actually buying something are people who probably don't know that much about photography. So I don't have to push it to that limit in terms of technical perfection or something. I have to push it to the limit of, so it's good that they like it, that they think it's beautiful, that they can feel it, but it doesn't have to be, Vincent Versace said something about living in the land of 2%, because he was pushing always for the last 2% to make it perfect. And I'm not living
there. Nothing's perfect.
I think there's two types of photo buyers, though, because there are some photographers, or actually the buyers, who ask the photographer what camera was used. They want to know if it was done with their 4x5, 8x10, or 35, or was digital, or was film. So there is that group of buyers out there. But then there's other buyers who go for the image, and I'm on the image side.
Yeah, totally.
My argument with people that ask what camera or lens or f-stop did you use, I say, would you ever have dared to ask Seurat, Monet, Picasso, what brush, what paints, what the name of the canvas that they used? Mm-hmm. It has nothing.
Yeah.
Those are just tools. Our cameras, our lenses are nothing but tools. You know, right?
Actually,
to the final product.
I would argue that that's not true. And artists have for centuries dealt with the technical aspects of painting, what pigment, what vehicle, how did you grind the colors, all that stuff. I mean, what you're dealing with, photography is an unusual blend of art and science, of right brain and left brain. And there is no right or wrong answer. There is your answer or there's somebody else's answer. I would argue that a lot of photographers don't know what the fuck they want. So they flailing around trying to find something that attracts their attention. And it's like crows looking for shiny objects. Ooh, there's a new Photoshop filter. That'll solve my problem and make my image look better. Or, ooh, here's this new paper that Epson just came out with. People that do printing, a lot of times they want to know what paper to use. Well, use the paper that you like the best. And in terms of process and technique, black and white conversion, what's more important is not how you did it, but the understanding the underlying principles of what the hell you're doing. To be honest, the black and white conversion in Lightroom is pretty damn powerful if you know the underlying principle. And it is basically based upon modifying or adjusting the panchromatic response of the sensor. Unless you're shooting with a monochromatic sensor, an actual black and white camera, everything is a color capture. And so you get the full range and can modify the chromatic response. It's like the old days with film. And I do get a kick out of these young kids now shooting digital that have no fucking idea the underlying principles of photography. But when you used to shoot black and white, we would use red filters or yellow filters or green filters to modify and change the panchromatic response. Well, that's exactly what you're doing in Camera Raw, Lightroom, Photoshop, Silver Effects, all those. I think it's important to do a survey of all the technologies that are available to you as an artist and photographer, but then pick a process and stick with it and get good at it. And don't be like a magpie looking for the next shiny object. That's all I got.
I think
can I chime in here on this just for a second? So back to this question of image versus technique, I would say that, speaking for myself, that image obviously is paramount. So before anything else, I think the image has to stand on its own as an image. But as a photographer, I definitely admire photographic technique, whether it's film or digital. I mean, the images we're looking at here, Holger, you have some wonderful combination of vision as a photographer, and then the ability to kind of translate that onto the page. And I it's not like I'm like, oh my gosh, I want to know all about all your techniques so I can copy them or anything like that. But I'm certainly respectful and admiring of your ability to put that image onto the paper in a way that has such a lovely result. And the same thing is true with a good film photographer. If someone's using a large format camera, and you appreciate the patience that goes into creating images from that technique. So I think, for me, technique plays a part in my appreciation, but it's the image at the end of the day that, either it's great or it's not. But anyway, everyone has their own opinion.
Cool. Well, Jim had something, and then we'll go back to Holger.
I think we're at this point where there are so many tools to use that require that you benefit from really understanding what they're doing. But that is a huge thing. And there's so many things that you don't know that you should know. It's like, I know about Nick, but I haven't really used it very much. I've heard about Topaz, I've never used it. So it's like, oh, but here's these things that are these new possibilities, and I could go learn those, but I could also just grab the camera and go make more photos. And so there is that tension, but there's always feeling of, I should know more than I do because there's all the stuff I don't know. But what's interesting is that looking at the folks who do weddings, a number of them are using services to outsource all the processing because they don't have time in their business model. And so I think with artists, we have to know both. We have to be able to do great images and great tools. But I think for a lot of working photographers, there just isn't the time for them to do both well. And so they're still doing that separation between processing and image creation. And I'm done. So anyway, great images.
Thank you.
Great. Let's go back to Holger.
Okay. So this is Santorini. that's, you've probably heard of that, and everybody's seen these images of the white houses with the, and the churches with the blue domes and that. And that's a place that has been shot to death by people with HDR cameras or phones who can do HDR, and which gave HDR a bad name. So when I was there, I was looking for something that was definitely not looking like that. I mean, I've seen the place where you take the picture overlooking Oya, but I made the one poster, the one image, and I never published it. This is a church that is on the edge of the caldera. To the left of it, that would be the sea, but it's so dark you can't really see it. I love that for the depth, because it has like these different layers of, you have the wall in front here, and then the first cross, and then the church itself, and the three bells there, and the sky. And it was as close to Ansel Adams as I probably ever get. This looks like this Mexican thing that he did. I didn't want it to be like that. Not that I was like, oh, here's something that might look like an Adams thing, but it was kind of proud when it turned out to be like that. And again, I had a group of travelers behind me urging me to go on. Oops, I'm all alone here. And this was something I thought, because mainly I think seascapes are like, oh, well, it's water. It's not really interesting. But here's, of course, the sky, which is always, I think clouds is something that Weston already said. You could go on clouds for ages. You can photograph clouds and it would never get old. And Stieglitz did it too. But here's also the water with textures on it. And you would think it's, with this, the sea is not wild that day. So you would think it's more or less flat, but it's, for some reason, it doesn't look like that. And there's the sun coming through the clouds and in the back there. And oh, and this is Ireland, of course. And I sat there thinking, I was looking out on the Atlantic, and I was thinking, as it says in the text, that on the other side, what is on the other side? And it turns out to be, and that's the name of the image actually, it's Chincoteague Island in, where is it? Virginia. And if you draw a straight line from this, the way I'm looking out, and I was thinking, if somebody, maybe somebody over there on Chincoteague Island sits there and is thinking, what is on the other side of this ocean? It would be me in County Mayo in Ireland. And this too is Ireland. It's Lahinch. I wasn't really aware that there was so much surfing in Ireland, but there is. And Lahinch is a great surf place. There's nothing for me, really. It was just, we went there, and this whole, again, this wild grass and in the wind, and this, I don't know why they put the fence there, I have no idea, but it got me hooked on this whole.
Yeah, those fences they're also snow fences and sand fences to try to keep the dunes from moving too much.
Oh, okay, so yeah, I learned something today.
Yeah, I grew up near the Jersey Shore.
Oh, that explains a lot. And this is again Ireland. I could I got thousands of things about Ireland. And with these, for some reason, I had the idea that the sky over Ireland was wider than it is at home. For some, I don't know why, but it felt like that.
Would you please enlarge that?
Which part? Bottom, top?
Where the water starts. It looks like there's grass.
Down here?
No, keep going higher.
Higher.
A little higher. Right here. Right here.
Well, that's all water. It's a lake, so that's the shoreline on the other side. What I totally like is this stuff down here that's underwater. These stones that are underwater, and then you get this huge reflection. It was unreal. That I have in color, I remember, but still, it was like the whole Ireland experience was like thinking about, this is the Green Island, that's the Emerald Island, and I'm shooting this thing in black and white. What the fuck am I doing? I had no idea at that point, but it turned out to be good. This is another thing of Ireland. I was living up here, let me see, this in this little house here, that's where I was living, and that's a pub up here. So usually at the end of the day, you're walking up there and saying, I'll go to the pub for one beer, which never happened because you end up with like 10 beers or something. Everybody will be your friend and everybody will buy you a beer, you buy them a beer. So pub always meant total destruction at the end of the day. And I love this one. Again, I use Topaz Simplified for where I thought there was too much, but these five boats were pointing to the same point behind the horizon that the clouds were pointing at. I had the feeling they would do that. Oh yeah, and this is, it's not always landscape, but this was, it's about an idea that I had that when I, people ask me why there are never people, any people in your images. And I think there always are, because I thought that nature connects pretty much everything. We were part of it, even if we're so, we manage to be so remote from nature, but still we are part of it. That's what we're going back to. And that's what, if you want to relax or replenish or what, you go to nature, you go to a lake or something, you go to the woods, you go to the mountains. You're not going to the city to relax. So I think nature is means that when I'm taking pictures of nature, I'm taking selfies really, because I'm taking picture of you and me because you're all in there. And this was something else that I thought, like you could feel with these three seats, you could feel the people that have been there, or you could make up your own story of the. I was thinking of these three seats as like on the left would be the father with a beer on the table next to it, the wife on in the middle, and this one that's a little tilted and moves towards the wife is of course the kid would be sitting in there and trying to get the attention of the wife because father is gone with his beer or something. So that's the kind of stories that I'm thinking of when I take images or look at them later when I develop that. And also this is the lions and this whole, I mean, it wasn't set up. I was just on the upper deck of this ferry looking down, seeing this, and I thought the whole geometry was kind of interesting.
Very nice.
This again is Santorini, which is totally not typical for it. It was just, I don't know, the stones, the whole texture thing. And for some reason I had this idea, which is a text of that in this image, that what if I was on the other side trying to open the door, doing the same on this side and it wouldn't move at all. I don't know where that came from at all, but it's just what I had at that day. And this is at the end of that summer when I was working in Greece and I was constantly island hopping in the Aegean Sea from Samos, which is close to Turkey on the east, to Piraeus, which is the harbor for Athens. So I was constantly on ferries or small airplanes or something. And this was the last ferry I took going back to Athens and going, well, home, whatever home was at that point, because I didn't have an apartment anymore. I was just going back to Germany and trying to find the next job where I could go to. So this is, I was at the back of a ferry looking back on what I was leaving behind, and like the last 6 months of my life, and that was the look I had. I think that was pretty great to look back on. And again, yeah, I keep coming back to the grass and the sky. I don't know why. This again is the Netherlands, and again I have this theme of something, an energy pulling towards the horizon or to some point behind that, and I get this idea of, as you see in the image, in the name, A Wind is Rising. This is, it's very influenced by You Can't Go Home Again by Thomas Wolfe. And that's Normandy. And I just like this size difference we see in between the cliff on the right and the small boat on the left. And it's called Where the Land Ends. This, with these cliffs, it's, I'm so sorry because we as Germans did that. In Normandy, whenever you go to these cliffs and the sea, and you want to take you want to find a place which has a good look over the bay or the beach or wherever you are, you will find a bunker there because we put it there because they knew where to put these things. And it's just shocking how much of the war is still there. And it's well, sometimes it's something you can take a good photograph of. But if you're just looking for landscape, it's kind of disturbing. That was pretty much it. That's my website and my blog. And you can mail me, of course, if you want to keep this discussion going, or I'll be there hopefully on Monday. But usually Mondays I'm working. So I can't be here.
Can people buy prints from your site?
They can contact me and then we can talk.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, this has been really inspirational for me because I'm a person who rarely ever does landscapes. I'm always looking for the people to put in there. I just say that I just don't see it. And everything I've seen here today, it's like, wow, I want to go out and do that.
Yeah. Beautiful.
So, yeah, it's been a really strong influence on me today.
Oh, very good. Thank you. It's a good thing. That's something that I feel about photography, that it's not like, we're not competing. It's something, I mean, mm-hmm. not like if I try to sell something, any of these prints, you can't do those, not because you're not good enough. It's just because your personality is different. You will sell something, create something totally different. So it doesn't really matter whether I've been doing this. I mean, on some level it matters, of course, but I can do something with 6 years experience in that you people like, and that's good enough for me at this point. And hopefully we'll get better, but it's good that it's not so much of a competition. Maybe it is if you're doing wedding work or something. Of course, then it would be people look at what you do and the other guy does and what is the price, and then, but not if you're doing something like what we do here. And in a way, then it's some people stayed. That's good to know. I thought I was coming back from the full suite and they all left. But it's also that with these ideas, I had the luck to publish some articles on like Cameron Raver's website had one of mine, and I had a guest blog post on Harold Davis' site about more like philosophy about this whole thing, what I think and what I feel behind it. Something like, which I didn't invent at all, but something I think is not talked about often enough. I have this quote here, I might read it to you, by Ansel Adams. Of course, that makes it legit. You have to believe it. You don't make a photograph just with a camera. You bring to the act of photography all the pictures you have seen, the books you have read, the music you have heard, the people you have loved. And that's something that I think people should think a lot more about, because I heard the same thing from Brooks Jensen the other day, because he was talking about photography as a diary. You evolve and your photography does the same because you evolve as a human being. And being a better photographer makes you a better human being, vice versa, at least that's what I think, what my experience has been over the last years. And that's, even if I only have this D300 here, which I totally love because it's overweight and obese like me, that's all I need. That's all I really want. I can live with an iPhone shot. That's good enough too. If that picture says something, then I can totally live with that. And if it really reflects who I am, then it's totally worth it.
I think it's very interesting. You're going to bring music into this. I've always thought that is an amazing idea. So do you have any idea how you're going to do that, or?
Oh yeah, this is.
Would it be at a gallery with headsets and people would move from photo to photo?
Oh yeah. Well, first we're going to produce it, just make the recordings, because it's going to be, we had the idea, we'll lock ourselves in a house for 2 days. And then we have like 10 images projected to the wall one by one. And then we have the recorded, but it has to be a bit longer than what we just saw. So I will extend those to like short stories of maybe 500 to 800 words or something. So this will be recorded too. And then we have, as a band, we sit there, see the image, hear the recording. Like anybody knows these Jack Kerouac recordings that he did with the backing of a jazz band? Mm-hmm. You should Google it, it's totally worth it. So we would see the image, listen to the voice telling the story, and react to that.
So you're gonna write, there'll be lyrics with it.
Yeah, like the text that I have now, but it's gonna be longer, right?
Oh, I see, okay.
It's kind of interesting, it will be, I'm not really a fan of free jazz, because it's just too, I don't see the point of it really. But we'll have a, the frame of a jazz standard, but we can improvise over it and give that. So we choose the melody and the piece to fit the mood that I see in the image, and then we just improvise over it. And sometimes it will not be the whole band, sometimes it will just be the saxophone, the guitar or something.
Mm. Who's your target audience for that?
Whoever likes it. First of all, it's me. I want to see this thing happening. I want to hear the music. I want to see the image. I want the whole package there. And then, of course, I mean, the problem would probably be I would have to produce a book or a folio of printed images and then a CD to go along with it. And that's not really that cheap, I guess. And because I just don't have a name, it will be super hard to sell anything. And
you have a name.
Oh well, but not. I'm not like.
You have a name.
Small one.
But while you're okay. Talking about printing, though, Sheldon's phone is dying. He wanted to ask you if you do print your own images.
Oh yeah, totally. That was, of course, in the beginning, you're just, I can be on the internet. I'll do it on 500px. I'll do it on Flickr or whatever. And that already is something, and people react to that. But that's the way we do it now. We want instant gratification. We want to see how many likes we're going to get for this. But at some point, I bought an Epson printer, and I totally understand now whenever people say that the image was finished for them until you print it. I want this thing in my hands, and that makes all the difference in the world.
I'm just going to jump in. I have to run, but I want to say wonderful photograph. I enjoyed that immensely. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us, Ian.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, John.
Great. Well, here we are at the top of another hour. Anyone else have comments or questions for Holger before we go?
It's wonderful.
Beautiful work.
Well, Sheldon here from Ireland. Great to see some pictures of Ireland, Holger.
Yeah. You're around Dublin, right? Oh, nothing.
Hi, Holger. Yes, I'm. Presuming you're talking to me.
Yes.
The internet is very poor here, but I'm in Dublin at the moment. Okay. I'm actually in a customer's.
Okay. But cool to hear from you. I'll mail you again about what we talked about. Oh, Ireland.
Yeah. Okay. I'm only getting.
Yeah, I know your phone's dying.
Yeah, everything's dying on me. Okay.
Well, all the best. Good to see you, Sheldon. Thank you.
See you. Bye.
Cool. Well, thank you, Holger. This has been really fun and really informative and just inspiring. I hope everyone else got as much out of it as I have here, and invite you all to come back next week and join us for more conversations.
Okay. Well,
super.
Thank you.
Well, thank you all. Let me close out Facebook.
Thank you.
Yeah. Bye. Thank you, Holger. Thank you. Very good.
Thank you, Michael. And a thumb up from Jeff.
Ha ha.